I'll try to make this check-in with council fairly brief. As you know, that these numbers in terms of numbers of cases are a moving target, correct? I'm pretty sure that nationwide right now we're pushing close to 400,000, and we have about 12,000 fatalities. The source for this is the CDC, and again, this is a fluid number. State of California, California OES later reported today about 15,800 confirmed cases, 374 fatalities. And then San Joaquin County recently issued its what's called a JIC report. It's a Joint Information Center report, 223 confirmed cases, 13 fatalities, and that's in our own county. So the order of magnitude is getting more and more significant, which is why we want to continue to have you know, a lot of resources placed towards keeping our community safe. This is a very important graph I think the community should pay attention to. The first chart up above shows what it looks like with no mitigation strategies, and just to kind of help orient folks at home watching. So the green is the estimated number of hospitalizations, yellow is those in ICU, and red is those that are ventilated. And so you can see a pretty high peak there. Again, this is no mitigation efforts whatsoever occurring. If you look at the graph on the bottom, you'll see that it's tempered somewhat. And what's that showing? It's showing that some of our efforts are working. Does that mean we're out of the woods? Absolutely not. We need to be vigilant about what we're doing, but it does show that we're starting to flatten the curve. The other thing that you'll notice is starting to stretch the curve out a little bit. So to me, that reflects that we may be at this a little bit longer than what we had originally anticipated. So the April 30th date that I'll be talking about, that the president mentioned about keeping the social distancing practices in order, could be extended slightly longer. So take this opportunity to just update you on recent actions. Last Saturday, April 4th, we closed all city parks until further notice. So park restrooms, equipment, playgrounds, picnic tables, gazebos, and sports courts have been closed. That does not mean that passive activity is not allowed. So we do encourage our residents to go through our parks and take walks, get out, stretch their legs. Effective today, we started removing basketball hoops given the lack of social distancing we were starting to see at parks. We were trying to kind of close them off and secure them with plywood that didn't work. We ended up actually having to remove the basketball hoops, and we can put those back actually relatively quickly once the order is lifted. And then finally, we're actively working with the district attorney's office, sheriff, and local police agencies to work in kind of unison in terms of how we are dealing with non-essential business enforcement approaches. If you have additional questions, we can get into that later. We have a Chief Milliton here, but we've got a range of steps in our toolbox from mild to strong to encourage compliance, and I think we're making some really great headway with some of our local businesses in that arena.
Cindy, can you clarify something on that since people are watching? You said on April 4th, city parks were closed, but you can still walk in them.
That is correct.
Okay, I just wanted to clarify
that. And that is still correct, that you can still walk in your parks. Okay. Thank you for that. And so just briefly give you a snapshot of what's happening at the federal, state, and county level. I mentioned the president had announced that social distancing will be in place through April 30th. We think that that may be extended based on some of the data we're seeing. Also, the CDC came out and said, hey, it's not a bad idea to wear cloth face coverings, particularly when you're in situations where social distancing is difficult. The state, as you've heard through our budget presentation, is deferring sales and use tax for small businesses up to $50,000 a year for 12 months. We have a paycheck protection program that the state has also enacted. That's for small businesses as well, and they want to try to keep as many employees on payroll as possible. There's a max of $10 billion for that program. An executive order was signed restricting water shutoffs for homes and small businesses. Tracy actually put this into place very quickly several weeks ago. And secured resources like hotels, motels, and other facilities, these are actually being secured by the state through the county for at-risk homeless individuals and families. Just wanted to give you a quick update. Negotiations are underway at one particular facility in San Joaquin County for hotel space. Details are unfolding of how that's going to be rolled out. And then finally implemented a statewide moratorium on evictions for residential and commercial properties. And we'll have, oh, that just disappeared. We'll have Leticia talk a little bit more about that. And then at the county level, we talked about this in our budget. They're looking at penalties and other charges, basically canceling those for those that can't pay their property taxes. This is for both commercial and residential. Then they're going to be looking at this, they being the county, on a case-by-case basis. And then finally, the San Joaquin County Department of Public Health had updated stay-at-home order to prohibit the use of park and playground equipment, non-essential travel, and extended the duration of the order until further notice, so it is open-ended. And so with that, what I'd like to do is turn it over to Leticia, that's going to talk a little bit more in detail about what's happening with eviction and foreclosure protection.
Hi, Mayor and Council. As we discussed earlier today, there has been a sharp increase in the number of unemployment claims throughout the state of California. The first week of March, there were about 48,000 unemployment claims that were filed. At the end of last week, ending on March 28th, there were 870,000 unemployment claims that were filed in the state of California. As a result, there's been a number of measures that have been taken on the county and on the state level. I know the City Council had previously also directed our office to put together an eviction moratorium, but given the county and state efforts that already apply to the city of Tracy residents, it may no longer be necessary. Again, on March 24th, the county adopted an eviction moratorium that suspended all residential and commercial evictions due to non-payment because of COVID, income loss, or medical expenses. That moratorium is in effect until May 31st. On March 25th, the governor announced that he had received a commitment from a number of national banks and state banks to provide different levels of mortgage relief, one of them being a 90-day grace period on mortgage payments. The public can go to covid19.ca.gov. There's a tab that says Get Financial Help, and that tab, you will see all the banks and the lenders and the different types of relief that they are offering. On March 27th, the governor issued an executive order actually extending the deadline for tenants to respond to an unlawful detainer, meaning an eviction action. That executive order also said that the sheriff will not be enforcing any eviction writs due to COVID. That executive order is in effect until May 31st. Just yesterday, I think the biggest eviction or foreclosure measure was taken by the Judicial Council of California. They are the policy-making arm of the courts in the state of California. Essentially, the courts have stated that they will not be proceeding with eviction actions unless an eviction is necessary to protect public health and safety. It also prohibits courts from entering any judgments on pending eviction actions for at least 90 days after the governor ends the COVID-19 emergency. So that kind of timeline allows the public and residents who are affected by this a little bit more certainty and an ability not to have to deal with this during the COVID-19 emergency. The second rule that the Judicial Council issued was about judicial foreclosures. So the courts will not be taking any action on any judicial foreclosures that are currently pending. Again, this is the same kind of timeline. It will be in place 90 days after the governor ends the emergency. If the public would like any more information, they can follow the city's Facebook page, which has included, we've posted a couple of posts on this topic, and we have received emails and calls about this matter.
All right. Well, thank you. Very informative. Open public comment. I know, like you said, we received.
And I forgot to let you know one thing that I just got a text on. So we've implemented this Spanish-speaking COVID hotline so that folks who speak Spanish can be able to get real-time information from staff. And if we're not available to answer that, we will pick those messages up remotely. That's actually live now. So I just wanted to make sure that you all knew that.
How do you access that hotline?
Well, there's a phone number. And I will go ahead and have staff give that to me so we can announce that later on.
All right, cool. All right, with that being said, thank you guys very much. Like I said, very informative, and appreciate it. We are going to have this time public comment, so you know what that means? We're going to take a five-minute break. And this will allow a member of the public to submit comments on this item, which is item 3C. At the conclusion of the break, we will ask staff to begin reading comments into the record. So we will be back in 5 minutes. All right, everybody, we are back. Before public comment, I just want to follow up the Spanish COVID-19 hotline. Again, that was the Spanish COVID-19 hotline. The phone number is 209-831-6380. That's 209-831-6380. All right, welcome back. Now, comments received will be read out loud to council by city staff. Total allotted time for public comment to be read aloud by city staff member will be 10 minutes. So, do we have any public comments?
Yes. Reading an email from Leah Austin. My name is Leah Austin. I am the director of the Center for the Study of Childcare Employment at the University of California, Berkeley, and I am now a longtime Tracy resident. Since the onset of the COVID-19 pandemic, I have been engaged with child care providers in California and across the country, and am increasingly concerned about the safety of group child care during this time and the protections or lack thereof for this workforce, as well as children and communities. Many workers in our community, especially those who are healthcare and emergency workers, grocery, food service, transportation, and warehouse workers, are in dire need of childcare during this emergency in order to allow them to work. Childcare workers themselves need to also be understood to be essential, and special provisions are required to ensure these services can be provided in a manner that is safe for children and childcare providers, as well as the community at large. As we learn more about the scarcity of personal protective equipment, PPE, and why not having PPE poses a life-threatening risk, we have come to understand that the combination of increased exposure to the virus and a lack of safety protection is proving deadly. This is not a hyperbole, yet many childcare providers are risking their own health and that of their families to provide services, or they otherwise risk losing their livelihoods and businesses and leaving a void that cannot meet the demand for childcare for our community when this emergency is over. I commend the council for recognizing the seriousness of this pandemic and demonstrating leadership by declaring a shelter-in-home order to protect our community before the county or state followed suit. I would ask that the council again show leadership on behalf of the community and request of the state and federal government that the childcare sector receive targeted relief to allow for 1, programs to close with the resources that allow them to sustain their program and staff costs in order to be prepared to reopen for children and families when this emergency is declared over. And 2, resources as needed for essential workers to pay for in-home childcare with strict health and safety measures as needed to allow them to work. Childcare is a critical community infrastructure that is on the verge of collapse. National estimates suggest that upwards of 40% of childcare may be lost as a result of this pandemic if nothing is done. Childcare program providers and their staff, who are regretfully members of one of the lowest paid occupations in our state, face decisions that place their health and fiscal well-being at risk without an intervention, and other workers in our community are at risk for not having access to much needed childcare on the other side of this emergency. Please refer to this link statement for greater detail and for examples of communities across the country who are doing right by children, their families, and caregivers. And she cited a site from Berkeley EDU. Respectively submitted, Dr. Leah Austin, Tracy, California.
All right, thank you. Thank you, doctor, for the message.
And that was the only email received regarding item 3C.
All right, thank you.
And for the Facebook feed, Michael Glenn writes, what is being given to small businesses in the city that have had to close or severely limit business during COVID-19?
Who would like to take that? Anyone?
We can have either myself or Andrew can speak to that. You've heard a couple of the opportunities in terms of deferral of sales tax,
right?
Payroll kind of protection, and there's also a number of other opportunities we're exploring. Andrew, you can discuss those.
Yeah, Andrew Malik, Assistant City Manager. So we actually put together a pamphlet that ED staff walked and sent to most. sorry. It was sent to all the businesses, and we even walked in some of the downtown with staff with TICA. But it's on our website, but it lists some of the things that we just mentioned about the paycheck loans and other types of things and how to. We're also going to be working on a workshop for small businesses to tackle some of that, some of those information as well, with the Chamber and TICA coming up. But this is on our website, and you can see all the resources that we're providing for the small business in the community.
So cityoftracy.org?
Yes, thank you.
All right, thank you, Andrew.
And further from the Facebook feed, Megan Kelsey writes, will there be any further updates or numbers given or information given for tonight's meeting regarding COVID-19?
Do we have any further information?
Not at this time.
Okay.
And another comment from Megan Kelsey. For more of a response from the public, please discuss COVID topic first to be able to hear more from the public. Thank you. And not seeing anything further on this item on the Facebook feed.
Okay, so we have Facebook, email, anything from telephone? Good. All right. Well, thank you, Michael Glenn and Megan Kelsey, for using the Facebook to get a hold of us.
Mayor, I'm sorry. There was just one when you were asking about the telephone that just came in on Facebook, if I may read it.
Yes, please.
Rosie Hurtado writes, we daycare providers cannot use masks as babies need to feel safe. They look into our face. We cannot wear gloves unless changing diapers as a need to feel comfort within our embrace. We cannot stay 6 feet away from all of our babies who need to be held when fed, when read to, et cetera, et cetera. We are essential workers who are very underpaid. Taking care of average three-year-old, we get paid approximately $4 an hour to take care of the child.
All right, thank you, Ms. Hurtado. Is that it?
Yes, that's it. Thank you, Mayor.
All right, thank you. Thank you, everybody, for reaching out. So that...
Mayor,
well,
can I ask a
question?
Hold
on. Let's conclude public comment here real quick. So that will conclude public comments. If you don't have any further, so we'll bring it back to council for discussion. Pro Tem.
Thank you. Actually, my question had to do with public comment, the response from our city manager. As far as Megan Kelly? I'm sorry. I wrote so fast what her last name is. Will other updates be given regarding COVID-19? While there may not be anything here, don't we have updates regularly, daily, online? For people to log in.
Oh,
and
absolutely.
Check.
Mm-hmm. I thought that was in the context of this evening, but you are correct.
So I think that's just important to note. So that if people want updates regularly, the city of Tracy is regularly updating all the things that are relevant to our city, balancing out what the county has put out there, what the state has put out there, as well as what the city is. So you have most updated information on cityoftracy.org. And so that was on there, but I asked my couple of questions then. While I have the floor, the county district attorney's office, as was stated on page 4 of our presentation tonight, the sheriffs, the local police agencies are implementing a countywide non-essential business enforcement approaches. It just says this ranges from mild to strong and occurrence compliance. Do we have a way of, what is the best way, I would ask, for citizens to report issues? Are we going to be proactively going out to see things that are, you know, businesses that are open? Because especially on Saturday, I'm getting texts, I'm getting emails, or I'm getting calls to say, you know, this business is open. I was just going to the bank and I noticed that this business is open. And so I don't know the details of it. And I didn't get in my car to go drive around there because truly I'm sheltering in place unless I need to come out to meetings such as this. I have tons of meetings online. Zoom is really blowing up these days. But as far as, you know, all these other, you know, businesses, I don't know, and I don't want to speak to the ones that were mentioned, but what is the best way for people to know or to be able to report these kind of things?
All right, thank you for that question. Good night, Mayor and members of the council. Chief Millington, of the Chase Police Department. So some of the approaches that we've taken with regards to identifying non-essential, we have our forward-facing unit is code enforcement, partnered with economic development. They are proactively going out, checking areas, checking referrals that we might receive via dispatch. We are tracking those on a daily basis. We get a number of complaints that come in. Oftentimes, employees that are in essential businesses and are looking for some assistance, or individuals who may see a non-essential, what they believe is a non-essential business, we would follow up on that. We also have a Go Request app. Ms. Bianca has been tracking on those and forwarding that information to us. Coupled with our Parks and Recs, Public Works, our city employees are out and about, and when they observe activities at non-essential businesses or what I would call rock piling or group activity in a location which is prohibited, then those referrals come to us and we would follow up. So we do have a proactive approach to identifying, and then when we get calls for service to our dispatch or through the app on the website, city website, like you mentioned, we would do a follow up.
All right, thank you. Because I just refer them to the Go Request. I don't know for sure who to contact if they see a business open, and then it can be referred to whomever needs to handle that.
We get referrals via email. I've gotten referrals from the city attorney's office, from the city manager, city staff. We take all all in input, and we follow up.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, Chief.
Then I only have one other question. That's as far as the negotiations are underway in San Joaquin County for the hotel space, do we have an estimate time that we're looking at completing those negotiations?
Probably about 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Councilmember Vargas.
Thank you, Mayor. I have four requests for this council, and I'm seeking support to bring four items back for discussion. And I'm not sure if my first one isn't.
Real quick, we're still on 3C?
No.
Huh?
We're not in
3C. Yeah, yeah, we're still. Yes, we're still.
Oh, never mind. I thought we were ahead. I have no comments, Mayor.
All right.
I was trying to finish the meeting.
Yeah, you caught it all. I was like, what? Am I missing something?
I'm gonna turn around.
I'm glad to know you're awake.
I'm awake here. Councilmember Arreola.
Thank you. So I had a few questions. So looking back at slide number 3 related to the actual curve, so I know that if we had no mitigation admissions, ventilator requirements were going to be 154 daily, but with mitigations at 60. Do you know the actual number of ventilators that we have available countywide?
Mm-hmm. Chief, do you know?
Yes, we do.
You know what? I may be able to get that information for you. I can look it up really quickly, and I'll report back.
Okay, if someone...
Councilmember, or Chief Bradley, you come up to... You're going to speak. You need to come up.
I don't know.
All right.
Okay, if I could get that information, that'd be appreciated.
All right, thank you.
I didn't hear it from Ms. Ramirez, in case people are interested. Federal student loans have also, there's 6 months of relief. A lot of millennials like myself, that's a huge benefit. And then I was wondering, Ms. Haruyama, if we had any update in Tracy-specific numbers. So I know I didn't see that in the report, but San Joaquin County, the last update they had on any city specifics, I believe, was from April 4th. And I saw there with 24 positive cases in Tracy constituting 13% of the county percentage. Do you have any updates on those numbers?
I have not seen those numbers, and Chief is confirming that we have not received numbers since then.
Okay, so that was from April 4th. All right, and then the last question I had is kind of related to Mayor Pro Tem's question on homelessness. So my understanding on the Stockton hotels was that it's supposed to be a countywide effort, but does the city of Tracy have any representation in that negotiation, or should we also be considering something Tracy specific?
It is through the county that is spearheading that. It is available countywide for citizens countywide. And they are negotiating, they're in the middle of negotiating those contracts and have asked us not to reach out individually as they're trying to negotiate a master contract with some of these hotels.
So that being said, I do appreciate the efforts that we had, but I think that we need to be very realistic. And unfortunately, at least myself, I've been disappointed with the county's response on some things. And I don't think that we can allow the county to have the only solution or strategy to implement to take care of this. So I would also hope that we can, if I can get, you know, a second on, if we can bring back a Tracy-specific solution for this in case the county falls through or in case we don't have a satisfactory percentage of resources from the county. We don't know what it's going to be like until we see it back from them. And by that time, it may be too late. I mean, this is something that changes hour by hour, day by day. So we need to take care of Tracy. And so I would like to make sure that we have a Tracy plan for that.
I'll second him on that.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Everybody will support that.
Well, okay, there you go. You got more than one. You're good. Councilmember Ransom.
Yes, thank you very much. So I have a couple of questions. First of all, I want to thank our staff for continuously providing an abundance of information on COVID, daily updates, making sure that different languages can access the information, making sure that you know, you're in constant contact with our council members. And so I just wanted to first appreciate that effort because it's going very well. I also had some questions in regards to the county modeling. So I love that it looks like we're really doing well because we are, California overall is doing well. But we also know that we were not even 2 weeks ago, we were 40% behind on tests being processed. Do we know what percentage of tests still have not been processed?
I don't have that information.
No problem. And it's normally coming from the county, just for the public. It's not the staff's fault. I just thought I'd ask. In regards to the statewide executive order restricting water shutoffs to home and small businesses, does that also apply to people who are not businesses that are not complying with the essential business model? So some cities and counties have used utility shutoff in order to stop restaurants from doing seating and things like that when they won't comply. So does this mean that we can't shut off those people too?
So the state order doesn't reflect that.
Okay.
But Tracy is not also applying that approach as well. So if that's something that you want us to explore, then you can continue a discussion on that.
Well, then that actually speaks to my next question, which I'm sorry to ask the chief to come back up, but you mentioned that you some of our means of tracking the complaints is we actually go out, we follow up. Are people complying when we go out? Are they, what do you see when you go out? What happens?
I will say, again, Chief Milton, Tracy Police Department, we are overwhelmingly receiving good contacts. Folks are compliant. We are getting complaints that we follow up on, some legitimate and some just lack of knowledge. But for the most part, we've had compliance. We've not had to escalate
Great.
To enforcement, if that's what you're asking.
That is what I'm asking.
Correct.
That's
we've not
good to
had
hear.
To been there. Yep.
Okay. Thank you.
So far.
That, think that
so
wait.
Far.
Wait. One other question. The Go Request app. So 2 weeks ago, people were doing Go Request app, and it was saying, we'll get back to you on April 7th. Where are we now on those Go Requests? Complaints when people put things on the Go Request app?
As far as timeline for response, I think I'd have to ask maybe Andrew, only because when they come to us, we refer them to our co-compliance and we act on them on a regular basis.
Okay.
I
don't get them directly?
We have a specific response flow of how that kind of goes through. So it goes through the city attorney's office, and then we have two economic development people that are assigned to respond to that, one for businesses, one for general inquiries,
okay. And
then those go out. So I would be shocked if there was a delay when people are having COVID-specific issues around compliance or concerns. We're on that.
Okay, so if I hear you right, we have two tracks. One for general business, those people might have to wait, but if it's COVID specific, we're on top of that, and they're getting a faster response Is that what I hear?
Yes, for the most part. I will say that there's some of the issues of whether something is essential or not. If there's some, like a gray area wobbler, our office is in communication with the county council, who is advising and in communication with the public health officer on certain businesses that certain questions have come up.
Great. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Chief.
Okay.
Thank you. So I appreciate that information because we get a lot of complaints about businesses that actually sometimes are essential, but people just don't realize they're essential. And so there's a huge education going on about, you know, warehouses being in operation or call centers connected to warehouses being in operation. But then there's also a deeper level of complaint in regards to, well, they're not practicing social distancing and there's no protection for the employees. So those things, I appreciate that we are actually responding to those things pretty quickly. And so thank you for that. And thank you for the response. I'm looking for my next question in regards to, oh, that answers it. Okay, so thank you very much. Appreciate it.
And to get back to Councilmember Ariola's question, there are currently 144 ventilators that are not in use and currently available in the county.
Thank you. Thank you, Councilmember Ransom. Councilmember Vargas.
Thank you, Mayor. I have one question.
Go on 3C.
Yes, 3C. Jenny, and I asked this question to you earlier, I think it was today or yesterday, all the days are running together, so I'm not sure, but I have an, I was searching on the county website, and I did found that it's a multi-agency communications meeting, and looking at the charge, it looks like, and I have talked to one or two supervisors, and the elected officials are currently participating in this, what they call MAC meeting. And supposedly it's a meeting tomorrow, April 8th, in the afternoon, where county officials, medical service, EOS, they all participate, including elected officials. However, we have not. I just found out about this about a day ago too. So I would like to know how can this council have the opportunity and the option to participate on this call to get more information or updates. How do we go about to just enter that list so we can just participate on that call?
So anticipating this question, I followed up with OES. And so the multi-agency coordination team was developed during a non-emergency time, which is why the Board of Supervisors is actually on that team. Normally, it would be made up of non-electeds and administrators. And so they recognize that that's a little bit awkward, and they, in the future, are going to be actually creating two groups, one elected, one administration. And one of the things of why elected shouldn't be a part of that is it's actually not recommended by NIMS and SIMS, because typically you want to keep your elected officials out of the emergency management aspect because your subject matter experts are doing that, and have really your electeds be kind of more of your public information champions. That being said, there is a couple of elected officials that are currently kind of calling in or sitting in. That's limited to one city. I believe that that is a governance issue, and I've checked in with my area city managers. That's not a practice that's being happening around the other cities. So my recommendation actually to your request is that I would be more than happy to take notes and minutes and highlight some of the conversations that we're having, and then send that out to the full council every week so that you're briefed. And if you want a little bit more information, I'd be happy to drill down on that. I'm finding that sometimes those meetings can be hit or miss in terms of information. And what I've also started pushing out to you are the JIC reports, which I think are useful. And so I'm looking to see as there's more OES reports coming out that I can submit to you that don't have confidential information, and I'm allowed to do that. I'm going to push as much information to you because I think some of the electeds were very frustrated and they're trying to get information, and that's really the intent. So that was my recommendation to you to try to keep that in the kind of rights lane, if you will. So if that works for you, Councilmember Vargas and the rest of the council, happy to do that. And we'll do that starting tomorrow.
That will be great. I think we want to make sure that what the right hand is doing with the left hand, so we have a comprehensive understanding of all the dynamics and moving forward. I will like that. I don't know how everybody else feels, but I think having your footnotes or the actions after those calls will be very helpful to have that knowledge as we try to communicate with our constituents. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
I would definitely appreciate that. To the point that was made, one of the frustrations is knowing that other cities are participating and that their council members are participating. And it has been incredibly, I don't want to say difficult, but we have to pull information out of the county. So, you know, to know that there's these meetings and these things are happening, if you can give us as much real-time information, then that works for me. Thank you.
All right, I guess I'm the last one. Thank you for the information. You know, we've gone a long way since, was it March 18th when we made our declaration. And, you know, I appreciate how hard you guys are working, and I know you guys are working very hard. And the EOC that, you know, you set up immediately afterwards, I know, Jenny, you're working pretty much 7 days a week, all hours of the night. So, you know, thank you for that. And I know it's not going to be over anytime soon, so... we appreciate your hard work, and you know, Midori, our city attorney, I've called you, you know, many of times at home, and she yells at me, hangs up on me, and then she calls me back. But no, she's been very good. So, and I'm not the only, you know, one up here that does that. So thank you for that. Our, you know, our EOC team here, Chief Bradley, Jim Millington, you know, thank you, and thank you to the whole staff. You know, one of the things that I think this you guys have done very well, and that we've led this county, and it's pushing out information. You know, we have been at the forefront of this, and I think, you know, leading the county is making sure, you know, our residents, you that are watching here tonight, are informed. Whenever we know something, you know it. And, you know, we have several platforms to keep you informed, and I know all of us have been answering questions as best that we can with the limited information that we do have. If we don't have the information, you know, we will try to get it for you. But for more information, I mean, please look at, you know, the Facebook page, Instagram. We have our website. We have, you know, tons of information everywhere to try to keep you as informed as possible. So I just want to say, hey, you guys are doing a great job. Thank you.